Okay, we're about to start. This is a debate on neuroaesthetics. Our debaters are Gabrielle Starr and Alva Noë. Gabrielle is a professor of English and dean of the college and the author of the Feeling Beauty. And Alva's a philosopher at Berkeley and author most recently of Strange Tools. So the rules are this. So Gabrielle will go first. She will get 25 minutes. Alva gets 25 minutes. Then Gabrielle can respond for 8 minutes. Then Alva, 8 minutes. And then we open it up to questions. They'll be both sitting here. And people can ask whatever they want.
Ned, yeah, do you want to say something about our next debate?
Ah, yes. February 4th, we are having a debate on whether any interesting mental qualities are innate. And the debaters will be Jesse Prinz from CUNY and Susan Carey from Harvard. That should be an interesting debate. So Gabby, why don't you go ahead?
Thank you. Well, thank you all for coming in the heat of this room. There's one seat I see here.
For Susan?
Okay,
all right, so there are no more seats. My bad. So, yeah, well, it looks like we're all packed in. All right, so thank you all for coming. Let me get started. So I'm arguing in the affirmative that neuroscience can help us understand how we engage the arts, and I'll explain a little bit more specifically what I mean by that. So neuroscience isn't really built to explore an individual work or even to explore an individual person's responses to a work of art. And that's for the very simple reason that neuroscience is probabilistic. Right, and in order to have a probabilistic inference, you actually need to have a large statistical population enough to make your claim significant. So that is one reason that we would exclude, even at the beginning, a focus on a work of art.
Gabby, can people see the screen?
Yeah.
So we don't need to turn these lights off?
Yeah, actually, let's turn the lights off because it'll be less hot.
Yeah, can you, so that's the guy back there. Yeah.
There we go. Awesome.
There
we go. How about that? Okay. So, but what I think neuroscience can do is explore something different, because the story of art is not just the story of an artwork. Art is the story of individuals, cultures, viewers, listeners, readers, and their interactions with artworks. If neuroscience has anything interesting to say about those interactions, it's a good guess that it would be in a few classes of experience that neuroscience has been working on for the past 140 years. The first of those is simply perception, right? I think these are probably some of the least interesting claims that we would make about the neuroscience of artwork if you're thinking about visual art. And these would be treating an artwork as something that appears to the visual field in ways that are very similar to yet different from other kinds of objects. But there still might be interesting things that we could say about the perception of visual artworks, as well as about the perception of things like music. How is it that we can understand harmony? What are the components and temporal relations when there's a violation of expectation in music? Musicology has been doing this for a long time, and neuroscience has been partnering with a lot of musicologists to think about exactly how it is that we parse pieces of music and what a musical percept might actually be. You also might be able to say some interesting things about things like rhythm, and this would be true not just of music, but also of poetry. You can say interesting things about linguistic processes. And so we would expect that if there is a cognitive neuroscience of art, it might begin with the study of perception. We also might expect that you could say some interesting things about emotion. There has been, certainly over the last 20 years, an increasingly fine understanding of the way that emotion is experienced, not just in the brain, but as a large somatic and social concept. And Lisa Feldman Barrett has been one of the more interesting thinkers in this and experimenters in this area. We also might be able to say something about the imagery that art produces. And by that, I certainly mean things like what you might imagine when you read a poem or when you hear a work of art. But imagery also has a place in a range of other artistic processes, and certainly in terms of reception. So when we are engaging with rhythmic objects, motor imagery is often a way of being able to understand the temporality of rhythm. There's William Empson had a wonderful statement almost 100 years ago that we use our that it's a kinetic art. Poetry is a kinetic art, and he was following on Horace, who made the point that you use the mind's finger, not just this finger, to catch the lawful beat of something that you read. So we have a very interesting set of work that's been done since the 1980s on imagery that also might be applicable to our experience of art. And finally, there may be ways to get purchase on questions of art or aesthetic experience versus what we might call everyday experience. And that's by thinking about emotion, perception, or imagery within the framework of a response to a work of art, as opposed to within the framework of a response to different kinds of objects. So at the very least, we would expect that there might be interesting things to say or things to learn in these four categories. And I think there are, and I'll say a few things about those in a moment. But if we're talking about aesthetic response, what is it that I mean by this? Certainly, it's more than a simple preference or simply pleasure in respond either to an artwork or to something that is not inherently artistic, right? A landscape that we might see, an unadorned human face, the night sky. It can spark a range of responses, confusion, disorientation, thought, exploration, imagining. Aesthetic responses are often quite mixed in valence. I think this is a key characteristic of a lot of our responses to art. It's not just that it's not simple pleasure, but that there is some sort of complication. We can feel more than one way about the art object. And as I gestured, there's certainly more than about just art. So the first premise that I would say is that responses to art don't have a single unique set of definable contours. And as neuroscience is not going to be able to explore all of the dimensions of aesthetic response, but we could be able to isolate particular dimensions and begin to learn something about them. And it would be most interesting to people who study art, or the different arts, I think, if there were something to say about questions that we care about, right? So one potential question that you might pose is what might unify the arts as a category, which to me seems a very interesting question. Arts appeal to us through different senses, through different modalities. There are different kinds of objects. The classes of artwork seems to be almost infinitely expandable and contractible. New arts come into existence. Is there something in common about our responses to artworks, for example, that might be able to give us purchase on this question? We might ask what processes are engaged by creativity. This is not my area of expertise, but there are individually folks, my collaborator Ed Vessel, who's here tonight, who works on, is beginning to work on creativity. We also might narrow our question to say, when we engage a work of artwork from start to finish and for a limited duration after, what is happening within us? And why I mean what I mean by within us, well, we can talk about. When I say that I'm engaging in cognitive neuroscience of aesthetics, it means something quite particular. It means that I begin with a perspective of aesthetic inquiry and criticism. This is how I've been trained. We always have behavioral investigation because you must begin any scientific exploration by an observable phenomenon in one way or another. And we combine that behavioral investigation with various forms of neuroimaging, from fMRI to EEG, and also to things like facial, looking at neuromuscular responses, cortical excitability. It's a range of things that go beyond simply the brain. And the question that I'm asking is not what is special about art, but what might be special about our approaches to art. And if we're really lucky when we're asking these questions, we might be able to learn something not just about these categories that neuroscience has been exploring, but we might be able to find out more than we expect. So I'm going to start in a way that a lot of neuroscience experience around aesthetics begin with a behavioral question. There are two very simple questions that you can begin to ask about how people express what people's enjoyment of things that they see might be. One is what they like, and we'll use like as a very broad category, but you also might ask them, ask how much people agree about what it is that they like. And it turns out the differences in agreement that you can measure behaviorally can help you to differentiate classes of objects. So at the very beginning, these are agreement measures taken from a range of different papers and different work in progress. So Jacqueline Langlois and her colleagues found that people tend to agree about facial attractiveness at a pretty high rate, 80 to even 90% of the time. And once you get more homologous subject groups together, participants, you have much greater agreement. People agree about natural scenes about half of the time. Suddenly you get this drop, however, when you move away from natural objects to created objects, so that people disagree about abstract images anywhere from 14 to 20% of the time. About paintings, we get a further drop off, and in work that we're just starting to do on haiku, you see only a 10% agreement rate with how much people, when you ask them a question, the question that we've been using is how powerful, pleasing, or profound do you find this artwork? And people will, what I like, again, as my colleague Ez says, you will hate pretty reliably.
Are those paintings not abstract? Do they exclude abstract paintings?
Nope. So people will like a portrait of a face more than, will disagree more about a portrait of a face than they will about a face, and more about a landscape painting than they will about a landscape. Okay. Now, when we think about the neural range of this, the question becomes, what does a neural perspective add to the behavioral questions that we are that we pose? So one of the things that's interesting about neuroscience is that you can begin to disaggregate early versus late processes, and you can see where there's shared agreement and begin to postulate why there might be shared agreement when it comes to works of art. So this is work done by Anjan Chatterjee, Teresa Pagors, Joseph Cable, and Russ Hepstein at Penn. And what they were doing was comparing responses for representations of faces and representations of landscapes. And they found that while there was overlap, certainly in brain regions to which, oh, I got mine, thanks. Aesthetic, if it works, let's see. Here we go, in brain regions that respond for aesthetic pleasure, in these areas, there also are distinctions. And what's interesting is that as you go further back in the brain, it's not on these on this image, but you would find that there were identical regions of the brain that actually are engaged in responding to these works of art. And that is because visual systems essentially enable the extraction of priority information. And priority information from a visual perspective of how it is that we move through the world is pretty consistent. And priority information for all of us involves many of the same classes of kinds of representations, right? Motion, we need to see. We need to see color. We need to see, be able to find those features. And we do it relatively consistently. However, higher order processes that tend to be engaged later and combine perceptual and semantic information with other classes of cognitive responses happen in these frontal regions of the brain, where we begin to see much greater differentiation for those different classes of objects that we saw behavioral differences. So what does that mean for art? That's faces versus landscapes. And I do want to make the, what I think, important point that there are differences in the way that we respond to what is clearly the work of culture and what appears to be the work of culture in a different way, landscapes, faces versus haiku and paintings. Okay, so let's go back to this question of how it is, what neuroscience might have to say about particular kinds of experiences. So emotions, my back of the envelope definition. They identify relationships that really matter to us. They give them subjective and phenomenal shape. They include, as Jesse Prinz would say, these kind of gut reactions or feelings, but also tendencies toward both actions and thoughts. There is a neural reference space that has been built over the last 25 years, but emotion also involves the broader body and the social world. When it comes to emotion and aesthetics, there's some interesting things to note. Perceived emotion in aesthetic experience is very different from felt emotion, which is to say that we'll all agree, most of us, that a piece of music feels sad, but we won't all agree that it makes us sad, right? So, and we can identify expressions on people in films and understand what's being represented relatively uniformly, but we will not share the experience. There's the action-thought distinction that many of us know has been historically important when thinking about aesthetic emotions. Are they somehow fictional emotions, or is there some other way in which we might want to identify them separately? We know, and I'll show you some evidence for this, that basic emotions, and the version of a neuroscience of emotion that wants to have 5, 6, or 7 basic emotions, like anger, fear, joy, surprise, this is completely insufficient for looking at aesthetic responses. And while there is overlap between what we might think of as the neural reference space for everyday experience and aesthetic experiences, they aren't identical. Now, this slide here is from work that Ed Vessel and Alva Rubin and I did a few years ago, where we had 109 images of artworks taken from a set of museum databases. We asked folks to imagine they were putting together, helping a curator determine what would be in a permanent collection. We asked them to tell us how much they were moved, how much they found the objects powerful, pleasing, or profound. And then afterwards, we asked them a series of questions about their emotional responses. And one of the things that was interesting is that we found not only that the emotion terms tended to segregate out into a positive and negative, a positive factor and a negative factor. In a factor analysis, we found various brain regions that were differentially sensitive to these two factors. But what I think is more interesting than that is that we found that there are certain emotions that load both positively and negatively. So that we have awe, for example, that is functioning in both of these spaces, a positive space and a negative space. We also found that some people were seemed to be making their decisions about what it was that they found attractive because it was either strongly positive for them and they didn't like the negative things at all, or we found that it was strongly positive in either dimension, that either one of those two factors was driving them. So you could begin to see differences in how individuals assess aesthetic objects by thinking about a richer kind of emotional space. We also have been able to do some interesting things, I think, with individual differences, because people disagree on what pleases them, as we saw from that original bit of showing that we agree 10% of the time on haiku. People disagree on why things please them. And because of that, you actually can begin to isolate what the neural dimensions of aesthetic response might be, as opposed to reactions to a particular aspect of a work of art. If all of us liked a single piece by Rothko, everyone in this room, we wouldn't be able to tell if that was something about it as an artwork, or if that was something that the particular hue and saturation of that painting might have simply a pleasurable sensation for everyone. So since I like one thing and you like another, if our brain responses are similar, we can assume that there is something about the status of the liking that is driving that, and not just the object that's producing it. Now, we commonly speak of being immersed in or absorbed by powerful aesthetic experiences, but there's also a persistent cultural strand that describes aesthetic engagement as mere distraction. And in the work that Ed and Nava and I did, one of the things that we wanted to ask is if there were some categorical difference between mere liking and powerful, what we called a powerful aesthetic experience. And so, because this is science, we did a statistical test. And the question that we asked was, if you were to compare the moments in which people said this was the most powerful, moving, pleasing, or profound artwork that I saw to all the others, there were regions of the brain that responded selectively to those powerful moments. And you see some of these regions here. I'll talk about them separately in a moment. But it turns out that these regions are part of what is known as the default mode network, which was discovered by Marcus Regel and colleagues, Deborah Gusnard and others in the early part of the 2000s. And essentially, it's one of several resting state networks. And by resting state networks, I mean networks that are functionally connected and talk to one another. And when they are not being, there's not a particular demand that's being asked of them. They are resting state. This is clue tied to the fact that the human brain has pretty much a continuous consumption of energy. It doesn't tend to change when you're asking someone to do something. It's not like riding a bike when suddenly you consume more calories. It's pretty flat. So what that means is something has to turn off for something else to turn on. And the default mode network is one of these resting state networks. It is a set of interconnected regions that include this frontal region, the medial prefrontal cortex, which we saw in this two slides ago, the posterior cingulate cortex, which is important here, the temporal parietal junction, various regions on the slide. Through a series of set of experiments, it's becoming increasingly clear that these regions, when they are engaged together, not separately one from the other, but we are talking about network level interactions, are really implicated in processes that subserve memory, theory of mind, self-reflection, spontaneous cognition. And what's important is they're generally anticorrelated with task and sensory motor networks, right? So that if you are attending to a task that requires you to look intently at something, in general, what you see is what we saw in those first three sets of trials, where the default mode network begins to, you get decreases in activation, okay? So that's what you expect to see for a task. If you give someone a task, these regions begin to subside. But they had the same task when they were doing that, testing the fours. It wasn't a special task. What was special about what happened was that there was a more powerful response to the artwork that they were seeing. And in those cases, and in those cases only, you saw this very quick rebound toward toward baseline and rest. And this finding has since been confirmed by another group and was published in PNAS a couple of years ago. So there's initial evidence that there's default mode network engagement with other arts, with musical improvisation, with literary reading, with story processing, and also with creativity. And one of the things that I think that this particular brain activation begins us to be able to think about is the fact that a sense aesthetic experience is in fact doubly directed. And we can see this in the co-activation of sensory networks and default mode network. And that may be a mechanism of a kind of dual focus that we don't see in a lot of other kinds of engagement. And I interpret this as a moment when and we have internally generated processes that have an unexpected match with our perceptions, and they cease to be in opposition or competition. So neuroscience has enabled us to identify a subset of aesthetic responses that are nearly unique to our that are nearly unique to our experiences of the arts. Now, so one of the questions then is, what about art might trigger this unusual pattern of engagement, an unusual neural pattern? Okay, the two things, the double direction. The default mode network is involved in self-reference, moral reasoning, self and self-identity, imagining the future and past, imagining other selves. So it may be that this is simply about saying, this thing is my favorite, right? This thing speaks to me and I love it. But another possibility might be that it's about imagery, because there are a series of studies that have shown that networks for imagery are distributed and largely map onto the default mode network. And as I mentioned at the beginning, evidence for evocation of imagery is really visible across the sister arts. And the last thing that I want to point out is that I said that it might be great if we learn things not just about what we would expect to learn from neuroscience, but if we learned something different. And I think recently we've learned more that behavioral investigation has been able to identify for us generics distinctions. So one of the tests as to whether or not neuroscience and behavioral investigation can tell us something interesting is if they tell us something interesting about a category that's interesting to the investigation of the arts, like genre. So Amy Belfi, who may be in the room, Ed Vessel, Kat Markowski, and I've been looking at responses to haiku and sonnets. And one of the things that we have found, this is just behavioral evidence, I'll talk about the neuroscience in a moment, has shown us that vividity of imagery that people generate in response to haiku, based on their own self-report, really does capture a lot of what it means when they say that they found a haiku powerful, pleasing, or profound. It also captures quite a lot, maybe even a bit more, of what it means when they say a sonnet is powerful, pleasing, or profound. And this turns out to be the case whether or not people are high imagers. People tend to create habitually visual imagery, vivid imagery, or if they're low imagers. It's pretty much the same. But here's the interesting thing that we found. We found that people agree much more about sonnets than they do about haiku. So suddenly, from behavioral investigation, we're beginning to think that maybe there's a set of testable questions that can emerge about how it is that these two different poetic genres can be experienced differently across people. And what's interesting from the neuroscientific perspective is that imagery is a natural candidate for a set of processes that would be that top-down, internally driven kind of experience that we talk about with aesthetic responses, and the bottom-up, externally driven experiences that modern aesthetic. We attend to aesthetic objects when we are moved by them. We attend to their surface properties, but we also engage with them in a different way. And physiological investigation should enable us, particularly around poetry, to disaggregate the top-down from the bottom-up processes, because the bottom-up processes, the visual processes, don't in fact match onto the imagery in the same way that they might with an auditory experience or with a visual experience, because the images, the black and white on the page, which is your visual stimulation, does not match to what it is that you see when you read a haiku, right? What you see inside. So why art? Why is art the thing that seems to be pushing this different kind of response? Does it provide a medium for engaging with spontaneous cognition? Are there privileged gateways, perhaps like imagery, that can move us quickly into a landscape? How does art actually work to engage internally and externally focused systems? The answer is, I don't know yet, but I'm really excited to find out. And as opposed to our pleasures in natural objects, that drop-off, our pleasures in artworks require that we respond to and learn to value what is unpredictable. And that art experience changes with each revisitation. So it makes sense that very complex systems are involved in that. I'll skip over what we now need to know, and I'll just acknowledge people who have helped on this work, many of whom are here: Ed Vessel, Nava Rubin, Amy Belfi, Alex Dinker, Eileen Tomio, John Stahl, Allison Isaacs, Kat Markowski, Natalia Meyer-Maurer, and Elizabeth Oldfather. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. I'd like to begin by reading you a poem. And I've taken the liberty of putting it here on the wall so you can read it along with me. It's by Walt Whitman, and it's from Leaves of Grass. I hear the trained soprano. She convulses me like the climax of my love grip. The orchestra whirls me wider than Uranus flies. It wrenches unnameable ardors from my breast. It throbs me to gulps of the farthest down horror. It sails me. I dab with bare feet. They are licked by the indolent waves. I am exposed, cut by bitter and poisoned hail, steeped amid honeyed morphine. My windpipe squeezed in the fakes of death, led up again to feel the puzzle of puzzles, and that we call being. Now, my name is Noë, N-O-E, with a diaresis over the E. Sometimes people call me No. That makes me Dr. No. That's not a comfortable thing for me because I don't like to be seen as a no person. I like to think of myself as a yes person. And I'm doubly uncomfortable this evening being on the no side of this debate. And so I want to say very clearly right here at the outset that I am not here to say no to neuroscience. I am here to say yes to art. And I am worried when I hear neuroscientists targeting neuroscience as their targeting art as their object of investigation, that the art falls out of it. The art disappears. Art has an expansive and complicated place in our lives. It is precisely its complexity and its expansiveness, its inclusiveness, that makes it so important. And the question I have is, can neuroscience possibly contribute to our understanding of that? The reason I've begun with this poem is I think Whitman helps me. I'm using Whitman to try to bring into view something of what I have in mind when I talk about the expansiveness of art and the problem that we face trying to understand it. So I'd like to make a few observations about this poem. The first is, quite obviously, that it is a poem about the experience of a work of art. It describes his experience of a piece of performed music. And that's a really remarkable and interesting fact about art. I'm not aware of any art that is not, whatever else it is doing, whatever other effects it may aim at or achieve, I'm not aware of any other art that is not always interestingly and richly about other art, or at least referring to or commenting on other art. I was just in Texas this past week. It's probably not where you think you should go to see great art. But this is Rodin in the Nasher Sculpture Gallery in Dallas. And right next to it is this by Brancusi, or Brancusi, depending on how you say it. Brancusi, you may know, was offered a job as an assistant by Rodin, and he declined the position on the grounds that a delicate flower will not blossom in the shade of the mighty oak tree. But I was just so astonished by the way this and this were in dialogue with each other. It is as if this one says, enough with that. Enough with this celebration of the body, with this beautiful anatomy, with this classicalness. I'm going to make something which comes from an earlier time, it's dug up from the earth, it's primitive, and it's a different presentation of us. That was just apropos of art referring to, commenting on, responding to, and being about other art. But the really striking thing in Whitman's poem, the thing that really grabs you right away, is the visceral, physical, bodily, biological character of the experience he describes. He characterizes the ardors, the passion of his response to the work of art, to the music, in the sort of terms normally reserved for other kinds of bodily passion, such as food or sex, hunger and desire. So one of the things that Whitman offers us here is an affirmation that art has roots in our nature as biological beings. It belongs to our species history, but not exclusively and not exhaustively. For after all, what is he here describing but his response to the trained soprano in the first line? I hear the trained soprano, and he's describing the experience of an orchestra, that is something which is taking place firmly and groundedly in a cultural space of musical practice and appreciation. The pleasures he's describing, however powerful and basic and biological they are also, at the same time, it seems, cultural and sophisticated and depend on the exercise of knowledge and training, both on the part of the maker and on the part of the listener of the music. And indeed, this very poem is the other work of art on display. And this very poem is one whose appreciation, it seems to me, does not produce in us the bodily sensual ardors that he describes, which is not to say that it doesn't touch us or move us. And of course, we, to get this poem, well, it's not just that we need to be literate, we need to know how to read and exercise those kinds of cognitive skills, but we really need to be part of a culture that understands the idea of the recital, the close reading, the paying attention to words in the kind of way that the poem affords. So Whitman here is offering a picture according to which the work of art is at once biological and cultural. It is entangled in that way. It is at once felt and passionate and emotional, and also cognitive and intelligent, sophisticated, if you will. So there's an entanglement of mind and body, nature and culture. And he goes on in this remarkable final sentence to say that when he's finally released from his choking, gagging fakes of ecstasy, what does he encounter? He encounters something like philosophy, the puzzle of puzzles, that we call being, the very puzzle of our being. So not only is this a poem about a work of art, but it is really a poem about art and what it can be. And whatever else it tells us, it exhibits, I think, the fact that the work of art is never just a stimulus for a response, but it affords us the opportunity for the exercise of a wide range of feelings, attitudes, engagements, inquiries, puzzlements, curiosities. It is an occasion really to do something. And I think that that is the aesthetic experience. And so then the question I have is, can neuroscience help us understand that? I'll stay with the topic of aesthetic experience. One of the interesting things, and this is a point, by the way, which Blake Gopnik, the critic and author who's in the room, has taught me. One of the interesting things about aesthetic experiences, and this is entirely consistent with what Gabrielle was saying, is that they're not stable, they're not fixed, they're not, in a sense, data points. So let me just run through a couple of observations that we can make about this. I'll do so quickly. Unfortunately, the slide isn't exactly in the natural order for presentation. But, well, I mean, just to orient thoughts, you know, imagine you go to a gallery and there's lots of pictures on the wall and they all kind of look the same at first, but maybe you're with a friend who knows the work and she talks to you, she directs your attention to this or to that, she enables you to pose questions to what there is in front of you, and sometimes something remarkable happens, whereas at first everything looked the same. Now things start to kind of pop out at you and take depth and capture your interest and attention. It's a remarkable thing that can happen just in the space of the time you're in a gallery, a kind of a movement from not getting it to getting it, or not seeing to seeing, or seeing to seeing differently. And one of the things that we can then ask is, well, where is the aesthetic experience in there? And one of the things I want to first just note is how changeable aesthetic experiences are. They alter in time, they elapse in time, and they're affected by a reflection on them while we're having them. Another interesting fact is that I have here aesthetic experiences are in dialogue. What I mean by that is my friend was a crucial part of what enabled me to encounter the work as I did, just as the docent or the wall plaque or my broader education or my art history class or the cultural prejudices that limit me or the cultural knowledge that enables me to take an interest. We, just as with Rodin and Brancusi, we are the work of art itself, and we, when we're engaging it, are in dialogue. It's a striking fact about aesthetic experience, not just that we disagree in the sense of I like it, you don't, but we dispute our responses. We take a stand on them. Wittgenstein once said, the question is not whether you like it, the question is why. And these disputes matter to us. If a person that you care about doesn't care about something you care about, it can actually threaten your friendship. I've seen it happen. One of my nearest and dearest doesn't like Neil Young, and for years I've been trying to figure out, how do I continue to love him? We persuade, and a good critic, this is something Stanley Cavell has written about, a good critic is someone who actually can, through persuasive language, actually get you to see something you didn't see before. So the aesthetic experience for me is a site where all this is going on. Another interesting and related point is that I don't think that there are clear temporal boundaries when it comes to aesthetic experiences. I've sort of already said that. You know, where was the aesthetic experience when I visited the gallery? Where did it stop and where did it end? Our conversation may go on and on and on, and it may be that something you say to me a week later transforms how I felt about the experience in the first place. I think it's clear that the aesthetic experience isn't identical to the perceptual episode in whatever modality that happens when you're inspecting or looking at the work. And now here, and this is, I think, controversial, is I'm not aware of any first order, I'll call them, features of aesthetic experiences that are common to all aesthetic experiences, or even dimensions, that dimensions common to aesthetic experiences that they all have to share. I don't think, you know, some works of art are moving, and some are not. And some works of art are moving sometimes, and some are moving all the time. Sometimes we need to learn to be moved, or learn to overcome the way it moves us and take up a different attitude towards the work. Something similar goes for liking and disliking. Some works of art, and I mean works of art of the very first rank, are boring. I have a whole chapter in my book about that. I think it's important to realize that, and then even if it is, let's say it's moving, let's say it's very moving, at the highest level of movingness, that's not the aesthetic experience. The aesthetic experience is that's antecedent to the aesthetic experience, which is consequent on that, which involves reflecting on that, questioning that, thinking about that, and thinking about the work in relation to other works and its effect on you. Now, one might think, all right, so there just is no unity to the aesthetic experience. That's not the view I would want to take, although I do think that the nature of an aesthetic experience is such that one might wonder whether one can meaningfully ask after there being neural correlates. If the experience itself is so stable and ever-changing, if it's not a data point you can just take for granted and then see what it correlates to, I'm not really sure what it means to say you're going to look for its neural correlates. But in any case, I think the kind of unity of an aesthetic experience is not like the unity of a sensation, but it's more like the unity of an activity or a project. And of course, every activity that we undertake depends on the exercise of cognitive capacities as perceptual capacities, and thus depends on the neural systems that enable us to do that. But it doesn't, in any interesting sense, I think, consist in phenomena at that neural level. I'll just very quickly share an analogy with you, which I think is helpful. I think that an aesthetic experience is a bit like a meal. I know there are some foodies in the audience. I'm not a foodie. But what fixes the quality of a meal? I'll just run through these. There's the quality of the ingredients, there's the brilliance of the chef and the way it's put together, there's whether you're hungry or full, are you surrounded by people that hate you, are you in danger, are you in a remote country, can you afford this meal, do you even have any idea how expensive it's going to be? Are you drunk, is the wine good, are you high, what's going on with the rest of you? What are your intentions? Is the purpose of this meal to sort of close a business deal or maybe propose marriage? And you're very nervous about what the outcome might be. And then, of course, it depends upon who you're with. Are you with the person you want to marry, or are you with the person you want to make the deal with? And what's interesting about this example of the proposal or the business arrangement is it brings out the way in which you could imagine 2 weeks later she finally says no. And that everything shifts. Suddenly, every aspect of the meal has changed its meaning and significance. You thought she was enjoying the food. She was clearly biting her tongue, whatever it might be. So I want to say that the engagement with art is like the having of a meal. It's intrinsically multidimensional, which is not just to say that it's determined by these, but it's determined by reflection on these while you're having it. It is just not something you can hold still and say, what's going on inside your brain when you're having it. Okay, just a few quotations to dazzle you with that I think point to the unity of the experience. This from James Baldwin: the aim of art is to uncover the questions that have been occluded by the answers. This by the artist Robert Fiu. art makes life more interesting than art. It's hard to parse that one. And then these are just from me. Art unveils us to ourselves. It lets us catch ourselves in the act of doing this elaborate thing. And I think it does this in very much the way that philosophy does. And crucially, you don't get the experience, you don't get the aesthetic experience just for the price of admission. You have work to do, and that work is not letting yourself get triggered, letting yourself have a response. That work is a very active engagement comparable to making a meal, which is why Dewey, I think, compared the consumption of art to the making of art. He thought they were equally complex. How am I doing for time?
You have 7 minutes.
I want just to run through a few. So what I've been doing now is criticizing the strategy of looking for the neural correlates of aesthetic experience. And my concern is that if you try to narrow it down or use some kind of operational criterion for deciding when one is having an aesthetic experience of one kind or another, one, by the very nature of the beast, loses the aesthetic experience. And this is an example of the way I think neuroscience says no to art. Another example, I'll just mention quickly, comes from reflecting on the writings of Semir Zeki, who's a great neuroscientist and also one of the founders of neuroaesthetics. He's sort of one of its programmatic champions. And he's written that it's axiomatic that all human activity is dictated by the organization and laws of the brain. That, therefore, there can be no real theory of art and aesthetics unless neurobiologically based. Now, this commitment that he articulates leads him to make a number of interesting observations. It follows from this that it's not at all surprising that painters don't use ultraviolet light in their work, because after all, ultraviolet light is not visible, and we're interested in visible objects, and what is visible is constrained by the brain. He also points out that when you look at a Mondrian, you exercise your color vision systems in the brain, and that's an example of the way in which your experience of the Mondrian is constrained by the laws of the brain. Now, I hope you don't detect a mocking tone in my voice, because my observation about this is merely, and this is, I think, important. It's important to acknowledge that any encounter with a work of art, by the way, he focuses on the perceptual cases. There's a tendency to do that, but as Gabby pointed out, the responses that interest us, the capacity, the faculties that we exercise include thought and intelligence and understanding and emotion, and not merely sensory perception. But what is striking is that he gives reasons for thinking that the brain constrains our experience of art, but only because the brain constrains our experience of everything. And what he leaves out, I mean, I've read the whole book, what he leaves out, I think, is an explanation of what is distinctive about art, how the brain constrains the distinct forms of experience that interest us or that we value when dealing with art. It's just worth noticing, because Zeki uses this word, no theory of art, I thought I'd share this wonderful passage. It's the opening sentence of John Dewey's book, Art as Experience. It's a little bit difficult to parse this sentence, but he says, by one of the ironic perversities that often attend the course of affairs, the existence of the works of art upon which the formation of an aesthetic theory depends has become an obstruction to theory about them. And I think basically what he means is that it's not about the object, it's about the experience. And we look at the object and we ask ourselves for, you know, what's going on in the object? What are its necessary and sufficient properties that make it art? When really we should be thinking about the experience, which actually fits in the spirit of neuroaesthetics. But then the question is, what is the conception of experience that does justice to art? And so in a way, with reference to this slide, I think we can sort of put our finger on what's at stake in our discussion. What kind of conception of experience can do justice to the experience of art, and does neuroscience have the resources to help us understand that better? This is an image that's been made famous in discussions by Ramachandran and his collaborator Hirstein. It's a statue of the goddess Parvati, who is the consort of Shiva. And Ramachandran explains that we like it because we like full-figured women. Now, of course, it's not a full-figured woman, but there's a justification for thinking that nevertheless we like it because it's a representation of a full-figured woman. And the interesting thing about representations on a way of thinking which is very established in neuroscience is representations have the significance for us of that which they represent. In some sense, they're transparent to that which they represent. So he can spend a great deal of time discussing this work of art without describing any features of it in its physical character, not its size, not its patina, not its religious significance. He just treats it as the sort of equivalent of that for which it goes proxy, namely an erotic image of a female, an eroticized concept of a woman or something. I'm not exactly sure what the best way to characterize what it represents is. This is an example, again, the way art just slips out of the discussion. He treats this just as a trigger for an experience, and what it triggers is what would be triggered by that which it represents. And so it is nothing but the trigger. The interest, the work for explanation goes by looking at what it supposedly represents. I think very similar things, very similar points, lines of reasoning shape Friedberg and Galese's work. They broaden the palette somewhat of what kinds of aesthetic response they pay attention to. They're very interested in the way the power of images allows them to produce strong empathetic responses in us or feelings of bodily sympathy with what we're looking at. But again, the basic logic of it comes down to the same. We have the experience when we look at a work of art that would be caused by that of which it is the representation. And the art itself is really just a kind of a trigger for this experience. But I hope I've at least made it tempting to you to think that the conception of experience that we need to try to do justice to this is not one which is adequately thought of as simply triggered inside of us. It's something we make through active, full person, intellectual, emotional, and sensory engagement with things that we care about and a curiosity about the nature of our engagement with them. Now, I'm not going to discuss this last slide. Had I had five more minutes, I was going to explain what argument I think Rembrandt is making here about the relationship between art and science. But I'll just end by saying this. I think instead of asking whether neuroscience can help us understand art, I'm increasingly interested in asking the question, how can art help us better understand ourselves, our world, and incidentally, neuroscience? Thank you very much. Shall I turn this off and I'll just close my computer now? Yeah.
Sure. Okay, Gabby Starr will now respond for 8 minutes and Alva 8 minutes. I'm being tough about the time, but you know, they're gonna be sitting up there, you're gonna be asking questions, they'll get plenty of time more to talk.
Okay, I turn on my little timer here, if I can find it. So, Alva, that was really lovely and I appreciated the way that you put in opened with Whitman there. I first want to say that where I think Alva and I agree, I think we agree that aesthetic experience is not something that is particularly temporally constrained. I think we agree that there are no necessary first order responses, that there's no single profile for what an aesthetic response might be. I think that we agree that difference contention and different claims about artworks are part of what aesthetic experience has to be. Where we disagree is that what statements neuroscience might make about any of those areas. Ramachandran and Zeki, a couple of you who have worked with me know this, I think don't represent the best of what neuroaesthetics can do, in part because they don't have very sophisticated understandings of what art objects are. Now,
just at a, from a practical perspective, when you approach a work of art in a neuroscientific experiment, there are many different ways that you can analyze it that don't reduce it to a single data point. You can take a portable EEG into a museum and let people look at an artwork for as long as they want. That doesn't mean that you're going to encapsulate the fullness of their aesthetic response a few days later, but you are getting something that actually is significant to that individual at that time. And there's no reason that one should support the claim or give full credence to the claim that because you're not getting the full view of what an aesthetic response is, that you aren't learning something actually important about what has happened in a defined period of it. And fortunately, I don't have to prove that neuroscience has the summative answer to all of aesthetic response, but just that it can either, or perhaps both, give us some interesting information about a dimension of it, or that the insights that we gain from neuroscience can be translated into new possibilities for exploring artwork yet further. And I think that we definitely can see that. I also would disagree in two ways about the claim that the work of art disappears in a neuroscientific experiment. It doesn't disappear to the person who's watching it. It doesn't disappear to the person who's reading it. And we see that, actually evidence for that, in the work that we do on sensory perception and linguistic processing when you look at what people is happening when people are reading. So to the participant in an experiment, the artwork certainly does not disappear. And when you talk to them after about it, they will explain what it was that they found appealing in the period in which they saw it. Now, does it disappear to the neuroscientist? That's an interesting question. I mean, that's in some ways, in a kind of very simplistic manner, do we ever see representations of artworks in the books in which people write about neuroscience? And the answer is yes. And do, and certainly in long form, people actually write about them in interesting ways? And I would say, as a matter of fact, the answer is yes. I would say, does it, because you see a two-dimensional representation of an object, mean that you are not having an aesthetic experience about it? I would say no. Because certainly people pick up their iPhones, they open a computer, they open a book, and they'll pick to have a table, art table, you know, book that will show them a representation of a Bernini, which they in fact enjoy seeing, or they would not have the art book on their coffee table. So just because we have transferred the form in which you have a presentation does not mean that the art experience has been evacuated from it. Now, when you shift from the context of a perception in a museum to perception on a screen or on a page, I would say, yes, you have changed that. But that does not, again, mean that it is not aesthetic. A gallery is not a natural space for the encountering of art. And in fact, I don't think there's a natural space for the encountering of art. You can read a book on the subway, on a park bench, in a classroom, on a wall. And in each of those cases, you can have a response to it that certainly has shifted in all of those domains, but you still are having a genuine aesthetic experience. So I don't think that the artwork disappears in the experiment to the viewer or to the experimenter. I also think that it's important that we realize that saying that art is philosophy is not necessarily the compliment that Alva intends to make. One of the things that I think is historically true about descriptions of beauty is that they always substitute something else for the beautiful object. That is what the work of redescription does. There is nothing shameful about that. Criticism does it, philosophy does it, and science does it. So in substituting a redescription of something for it and changing the dimensions in which you represent and understand it, that is the work of human inquiry. And again, no discipline has any particular lock on it. Finally, I just wanted to say one thing that I forgot to mention. This question about how we've been able to explore genre in different ways in behavioral analysis. I just want to mention one other quick example, which is that Ed and some other of our collaborators have been looking at the way in which moment-to-moment responses to music, particular genres, people will agree about those more than they will have a shared summative judgment about the art object as a whole. And the possibility of beginning to disaggregate some of those retrospective versus individually temporal moments is a really interesting possibility that the neuroscience of art opens up. Thank you, Alva. I look forward to more.
I'm going to be very brief because I'm not really sure how most productively to continue just in this vein. I think the questions you raise about pictures of artworks is interesting. Those are very interesting questions. Is looking at a digital image of some canonical work of art a way to engage with art? And I think probably there's not a yes or no answer to that, I think. I just to give an example, I don't know if any of you saw the Andy Warhol show that was at MoMA recently. Blake took me. And I saw these Campbell soup can paintings, which of course I knew very well. I'd seen book reproductions of those all my life. And yet seeing them was a very different experience. I saw things that I had no way to imagine were features of the works. But that's not what I'm really concerned with. What I'm more concerned with is when you stand in one of those Campbell's soup can paintings, what you're confronted with is this. What the bleep am I looking at? Why that? Why here? What is it showing? What is it making? What is it commenting on? What is it? Is it art? Is it art at all? Now, I compare that questioning mind to the mind that says, okay, here's some art, rank it, what's more moving than the other. Now, I thought actually what you do in the work is very clever to say, imagine you're a curator, right? You do contextualize it in a way which makes it quite cognitively more subtle than simply rank it. But still, at the end of the day, I think that works of art, and this is true of, I think, works of art always everywhere. I don't think this is a particular truth only about recent art. Works of art are, they're problematic for viewers precisely because you don't know in advance exactly what they're doing. And so I think how to study that is, I think, still, I still haven't heard an example of how what goes on there is illuminated by these neuroscientific methods. I should say that some of you who know my other work know that it turns out I have a lot of criticism of neuroscience more broadly for reasons that have to do with, I won't belabor this now, but with what I think has to do with its internalism, its representationalism, and its individualism. Neuroscientists tend to be kind of, they don't like to say this, but they tend to be sort of idealistic. They think that the world is in your head and the brain makes it. So of course it's not an issue that you study pictures of works of art rather than the works of art themselves, because after all we ever have is a picture. The world, our brains screen off the world. Objects are screened off by their own neurological effects inside of us. That's why there was, in a longer version of this, I discuss a claim that's been made. It's actually a really interesting claim by people interested in neuroaesthetics that we can think of the work of the artist itself as a kind of crypto-neuroscience. So Patrick Kavanaugh has a paper called Paint Artists Are Neuroscientists. And that's because he thinks that he's working with representational art and is asking the question, what constrains whether we experience what is represented when we look at it? And he thinks it teaches us something about the neural representations depending upon how we judge it. So the fact that, for example, we don't notice that shadows are typically misrepresented in Renaissance paintings shows that our internal neurological representation of shadows isn't sensitive to that mistake. It means in some sense, so we're learning something about our own limitations. I'm not sure that does follow, but it certainly does follow if you accept that if you accept that actually we are already working with pictures inside of our head, which I think is, I mean, in a weird way, I think a lot of neuroaesthetics, and certainly this is true of the first generation people that you're happy to criticize with me, really starts off from a pictorial art-based conception of what's going on inside the head. Maybe it's an appropriate time to get other voices into the discussion, or unless you'd like to respond again. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
So you two can share that one.
Yeah, so this is for Gabby. So you made a pretty interesting case that neuroscience can help us understand our response to art. But I'm interested in how strong a claim you're willing to make about whether neuroscience can help us to understand art itself. For example, whether you think neuroscience can help us understand specific artworks. Do you have some other examples you think of specific artworks that that findings in neuroscience help us to understand?
No, actually, I don't, for the reasons that I claimed at the beginning, that any claim from neuroscience is a probabilistic claim about a class of objects, not a claim about a particular object and a set of events. So that precludes the possibility, I think, of neuroscience being able to say that this is the component of this object that is valuable.
Okay, so let's make it about about classes of objects. Mm-hmm. Then, could you give an example of a claim about the class of artworks you think findings in neuroscience help us to establish?
So, I would say that the work that we're doing now on genre actually is one of those places where we can, if we can say that we started off from the question of trying to think about what exactly do elements of form contribute to our experience of artwork. And so we wanted to pick two kinds of poems that were short enough to be read in a single setting and that had constraints placed on them that would allow you to compare across the class. So sonnets have particular rules to them, haiku have particular kinds of rules to them, and by looking at them as classes, and if we see behavioral and neural differences, then I think you really can begin to say that that there are differences there. You also can, as I said, disaggregate various kinds of visual objects, begin to think about what's the difference between something that is clearly an artifact of culture as opposed to something we interpret. And here I'm gesturing toward this question of a picture of a landscape, which we know we're not putting a window in front of people in an MRI, as opposed to a painting of a landscape, that we can begin to differentiate some of those things in our responses to.
I want to ask Gabby a question. So in your paper with Vool and Rubin, the neuroimaging paper, so she, the subjects are rating works of art from a scale of 1 to 4, 4 being the highest. And the result you mentioned in your talk was that the 4 versus the others is there's a dramatic disconnect between the 4 rating and the 1, 2, and 3 rating in the medial prefrontal cortex. But you also mentioned in the paper, and something you didn't mention now, which is that there are other regions that show a gradual increase. Now that suggests to me that maybe there are two different aesthetic processes, and that would seem to be a feature of our aesthetic experience that we might be able to find in our first personal judgments that would actually maybe give us some insights into our reactions to things. If there's one more continuous response and one really discontinuous kind of response. And I should say that a similar thing has happened in moral psychology recently, where the study of our moral intuitions has shown that there really are two kinds of moral intuitions, and I think that's been quite valuable in understanding our approach to morality. So, yeah, go ahead.
So I'd say that there are three different sets of findings, there are classes of findings in that original paper. One was the kind of step where you really have the kind of indistinguishable response and then a significant change. We found two other patterns, one which was purely a linear increase and one that showed if you had an initial depression in the system, just moving up linearly over those areas. Those, physiologically, those two different responses could have something that has a lot to do with the way those brain regions function relative to the baseline condition. And maybe what you're talking about is just two aesthetic systems, right? But then those two patterns just have to do with particular local issues. Or, in fact, you might have three systems that are being integrated when you're looking at aesthetic responses. There are other questions that have to do, and this goes to some of Alva's concerns. We still don't know if this default mode activation is tonic in some way. Are you looking at an oscillation between two different brain states? Or are you looking at some kind of a thresholding where you actually have the full co-activation of the systems, and trying to disaggregate those actually is interesting, because the question of two oscillating kinds of conditions seems to raise interesting questions about aesthetics as well.
If I could just ask a very brief follow-up about that study, do you present the subjects with non-eye objects as well and look at their responses if you ask them to rate those?
We're doing that experiment now. Mm-hmm. And some are selected by the participants and some are selected. We have IKEA. Dennis Kelly, I don't know if Lauren Vale is here. Lauren has been doing this with IKEA furniture.
Which is sort of in a design art space.
Not this particular IKEA furniture.
I'm just curious, what is primed already by pre-selecting a class of works which by mutual agreement are called art?
Yes.
I don't know how you would decide that something is or is not art. As an art critic, I couldn't make that distinction automatically. Certainly the IKEA, I've seen lots and lots of IKEA objects presented as art, and they seem perfectly credible to me as art.
I think you can contextualize, certainly. You can tell people these are pictures from a catalog from IKEA. These are, and we contextualize our work all the time. Right? It's not the act of place.
But just relate this to the kind of point I'm making about leaving the art out of it. In a way, what I'm trying to say is that's where the art is. The art is in that, not being certain whether it's art and trying to adjudicate that in the real world. So it's a little bit like saying, I was going to say it's the example of where you try to probe people's moral judgments by telling them these are the moral judgments and these ones have nothing to do with morality. And then, well, maybe actually sometimes the questions of great moral significance come from realizing that this other judgment is or isn't. It's at least in the space of morality. Sorry, Paul was jumping.
I wanted to see if I could get a little bit clearer about what seemed to be a very major bone of contention, which is there an identifiable distinctive thing called an aesthetic response or experience of an object? It seems to me that that's very crucial. It was crucial to the skepticism that Alva was developing. And you were quite sanguine about saying, well, I'm not sure that there is a unified thing there. There's certainly no sort of constitutive features that I can isolate. And I was puzzled about why that's something that neuroaesthetics can afford to say, because if it is looking for the neural correlate of experience, it's got to be the neural correlate of a distinctive kind of experience. I mean, when I stand in front of a painting, you know, all kinds of things may be going on. The responses are, you know, they could even include thinking about my laundry, so that's not, it's not enough to have some imaging of what's going on in the brain unless one knows what it is that one is looking for. So this by way of saying, I didn't see why you could be sanguine about that. And by the way, it really should be at the level of the experience, not of the objects, because one has aesthetic responses to landscapes, which are not art objects. But to make the case that there might be something unitary going on, it seems to me we should look at the most elementary aesthetic responses, not at the complicated responses that one would have to a sculpture or an entire meal or any of those things. But just, for instance, the kind of appreciation one might have for a well-made wine, which one
takes something very simple.
It's simple compared to the example that have been discussed. It's by no means simple in and of itself, but there is, when you think about that case, you seem to recognize the existence of a kind of interested, as Kant would have put it, appreciation of the sensuous appearance of something, mm-hmm. which you might think of as the core of what's going on in much more complicated cases, but it really is important to start with that.
So the reason that I'm sanguine about it are a couple. I mean, one, Dennis's lab is looking at Jolly Ranchers compared to art and IKEA. and pictures of teddy bears and many other things. But the reason that I'm sanguine about it is that you can define a subset of aesthetic experiences about which we can make a claim. So I can, aesthetic experience is elastic enough that the experience of boredom can count as aesthetic, right? But that does not mean that it's paradigmatic of an aesthetic response. I think that there are, and so I'm not going to say that we have identified either a brain state or a experiential state or physiological state that is the only aesthetic experience. But I am saying that we have been able to identify a particular kind of peak response, which people themselves will say, this was really meaningful to me. And across objects that are so different from one another, that has a similar profile that I think you can actually make claims about it. Now, you can also make claims about subsets, further subsets of the response, in terms of aesthetic pleasure or emotional responses. And I think that those are also legitimate ways of exploring aesthetic response. But I don't think that we have to... let's take the study of language, right? When you're exploring language as a neurolinguistics, you are going to divide the study of language into a whole range of component processes and be able to make claims about them. Being able to divide it thus does not mean that neurolinguistics as a field doesn't exist. It just means that you are taking slices of it for evaluation.
Could I make do you mind just a very small comment? Because Paul's question made me think of something else that was interesting to me, but that I hadn't found a way to articulate yet. And it has to do with your interpretation of the default mode network. Mm-hmm. So one of the points you emphasize is that it's anti-correlated with engagement with the environment, sensory motor engagement with the environment, suggesting that it's correlated with something like a contemplative attitude or something, some sort of retreat. Now, I'm not convinced that that's true of the default mode network. But even if it is true, I wonder if what you could be tracking and calling aesthetic response is something like thoughtful attention or contemplation, which of course is not restricted to art by any means, but you can contemplate a problem or think about your breakfast or kind of sit back and worry about whether, you know, your pants are getting tighter. There's all sorts of things you can do in a kind of disengaged mode, which, if the theory of the default mode network is right, I'm just wondering if you, because I'm skeptical that you're picking out art experience. This fear I have
I think that there's a relatively straightforward answer to that, is that we're asking people to encounter art in each one of those cases, and to think about the art that they're seeing. So, if they are telling us that they are moved by this particular object and that it's aesthetically powerful to them, and that's when we're seeing the response, then I do think we're picking out something, not about art, but about particular slice of aesthetic responses to art. So you don't see this response. I mean, you can have... what's distinct is I can give you, there's a set of tasks that I could give you that would involve default mode activation in an MRI, but it would be anti-correlated with other networks that it's not anti-correlated with in the aesthetic sense. So what's important is not just the activation of the default mode network, but that it's co-activated with things that usually are excluded from crosstalk. So what it represents for me is the sense that sensory information is being integrated in a particular way in aesthetic responses, that sensory information and peak aesthetic responses, that it's not being integrated in a whole range of other kinds of experiences. And so the question is why, and that we don't yet know.
So it would be very interesting to see if there are other conditions mm-hmm. that could produce that pattern. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't know if you know about this, but a little while ago, a couple of hundred art critics were asked what the most important artwork of the last 100 years was. And I don't know if you know what the answer was, and the answer was, and it's completely cogent for me, was Marcel Duchamp's Fountain. And you probably know Marcel Duchamp's Fountain is just the normal store-bought, even possibly IKEA-bought, urinal, right? That, for people like me is the paradigmatic aesthetic experience of our time. A lot of the aesthetic experiences you're talking about, I barely even recognize as having anything to do with what I care about in art. For instance, the experience of sipping wine is barely akin to anything I do when I look at art, and I'm a pretty experienced art looker. Can neuroaesthetics deal with Marcel Duchamp, not just deal with him, but recognize his central importance to what aesthetic experiences are today? And can you imagine a world where horrible people like me convince everyone else not to care about profundity, what's your term? Powerful, pleasing, or profound art, not to recognize those as relevant to aesthetics at all, but to imagine that talking for a year about a urinal is actually what the aesthetic experience is about. And if, in fact, I could convince them all to hate all the things that you think are central to aesthetics, do you have a problem on your hands? That is, if I can transform what aesthetics is for everyone, what happens to your reading of the neuroaesthetic reading of what you think are aesthetic responses? Because frankly, they seem a little bit like, frankly, and I don't mean to be mean about this, 19th century cliches of what art is, and I don't even recognize them as part of what aesthetic experience is for the 21st century.
I think you have a particular version of aesthetic experience that is shaped by expertise. And it is possible to educate people. You didn't arrive at this at the age of 15 or 18, this particular shape, and so it was the product. Most people don't.
Most people don't.
But he's proposing that this would be a learned experience. So I would say, for the sake of argument, that yes, you could convince everyone that was the shape of aesthetic response. If that were the case, I would have to know experimentally whether it looked like what these responses are. And until we actually do that experiment, I actually don't know. So I don't think a priori there's a problem for neuroaesthetics about it, because that state could be investigated similarly.
But you don't think they've been taught their
Of course they have, yeah. And actually there's a lot of interesting work that's been done on music, and there's more work that's being done now on visual art. My colleagues at MSU are looking at expert readers of sonnets versus non-expert readers of sonnets and trying to see what the relationship is between those. So learned experience actually absolutely is going to shape these responses. And neuroaesthetics can't deal with the, so there's a guy named Bill Seeley at Bates who has a really great piece about this, where he argues that, the expert opinion of an art object is what is aesthetically salient to the expert is a whole range of cultural associations that are come along with the knowledge that is expertise, which is that the Duchamp piece changed what looking meant from that moment on within certain elite spaces of art. That knowledge is not available to every viewer of the Duchamp. So there seems to be, and it's really, I would recommend the piece that it just came out this year, that if we're really just talking about a response to a particular object by any individual, then that's a very, very different idea of what aesthetic salience means than something that's more based on a feeling-oriented version of aesthetics. But I would not exclude a feeling-oriented version of aesthetic experience, because it is one that is very largely shared across. And if you were to convince everyone that the urinal was the paradigmatic art object, you would have to continually do that for every individual who was born after them and after them and after them. Because I really don't think that teaching someone that is paradigmatic is a process of education. It's not going to be inborn in other people. So you would.
As opposed to other aesthetic experiences that are inborn?
Yes, some of them are. Absolutely. I mean, Ed has done work with human infants that shows that at 4 months old, and yes, there's visual experience of four months old, their human infants show aesthetic preferences, and they show aesthetic preferences about which they agree much more than adults do. So, and aesthetic preferences for abstract representations.
How do you know their aesthetic preferences?
So there's a long history of behavioral investigation with infants that shows a correlation between the amount of time that they look at something and their enjoyment of it. And, so it's, while that's not a perfect example, it correlates with a lot of physiological responses, and you can do the same thing with adults, and you actually can compare with something as semantically impoverished as an abstract image, and by that I don't mean abstract art, but something like a fractal pattern, something as semantically impoverished with adults, and you can see very similar patterns. So I think that you are seeing something there. This is that.
Can I just add something very brief on, do you mind if I add something brief on this? First of all, he didn't just put a urinal on display. He turned it upside down, and he signed it. Just to keep the record straight. Second of all, this issue that's come up just needs to be, I don't know whether we'll pursue it now, but it needs to be noted that the issue of universality has come up. And one of the questions is art universal? Is aesthetics, are aesthetic responses universal? One thing that's beyond any question, I think, is that all people everywhere are capable of aesthetic responses or appreciating art. But it's a very interesting, for me, historical question whether, in fact, art practices as we know them are universal. I mean, just as mathematics developed in certain parts of the world at certain times and has a cultural history, it seems that art does too. And we need to be very careful, I think, about assuming the universality, which has a bearing on the status of the biologization of the study of art.
This is also a question for Professor Starr. So a lot of the questions and also Professor Noah's main point have focused on this question whether there is a unified enough thing called the aesthetic experience for which you then could provide a neural correlate. Let's grant that. Let's just grant for now that, okay, there is a unified enough thing and you found the neural correlate. I'm still wondering what that now actually tells us about the aesthetic experience. I could say, I knew before you did all your neuroscience that a lot of imagery was images were involved, and I knew before that I was undergoing a certain emotional response and some bodily states and all of that. And moreover, you could also say that what's actually really important in the aesthetic experience is precisely the inside view, so to speak. You know, the what it's like to actually undergo this experience. And the only way to learn more about that is just to have it and be very reflective about that and maybe talk to my friends and compare notes and all of that. But neuroscience is just not at all speaking to that.
You know, it's a familiar kind of question to ask about what the point of neural investigation is, as opposed to a kind of full and florid phenomenological experience. I think the answer is multifold. And the first case, there is simply value to learning about how our brain works, and that thing exploring the different ways that we engage with different kinds of objects is not going to change necessarily your subjective experience of it, but redescription does not always change your phenomenological experience of it. Sometimes it does in particular cases, but it does not always. That's not a falsification of the enterprise. It also can focus our attention on different kinds of states. So if I had never started studying the neuroscience of aesthetics, well, I would recognize, you know, I have a PhD in English literature, I would recognize and work that on that imagery exists. I would not be able to look at and disentangle some of the components of motor imagery across the arts in a way that I can now, knowing how some of that motor imagery works in different circumstances. I also would say that, you know, this particular exploration has given me new insight, for example, about how genre actually functions, because I would not have thought going into it that sonnets should have a higher level of agreement than haiku do. There seems to me no fundamental reason, and no one has proposed why we should agree more about sonnets or prose passages than we do about haiku. And if that's an insight that comes from neuroscience, I think that's valuable.
Can I say one thing about that? I mean, so the point wasn't to say, as Alva Noë also started to start, I'm not saying there's no value to neuroscience. Yeah, it's very valuable to learn how the brain works. I was just saying that it doesn't tell me anything about my aesthetic experience to learn how my brain works. And for example, the genre thing, I mean, just asking people about what they think about sonnets and how much they like them will give me the agreement results without having ever looked at any brain image.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of that's
so
well,
I would
not
say,
the question, you know, the
yes.
main point
so
there
I would say
would
that,
the neuroscience part.
That in particular, if you sit in an English class in the United States of America, someone is going to give you a range of information about a sonnet that is probably not going to change the phenomenal shape of your response. That doesn't make it not literary criticism or literary history. Some of it will, but not all of it will. Okay, so I don't think that that's particularly a criticism that you would lay at the door of a neuroscientific investigation of it. So that's the first thing, right?
I didn't say that.
Yes, but it's always the work of redescription, right? I mean, and this is what all human inquiry is. It's the work of redescription and discovery and exploration.
What does that mean?
The work of redescription. So what Alva did was he took a poem by Walt Whitman, and he redescribed what the poem was, right? He said that this is, and you said all the things that it wasn't. You said that the poem does not produce in me the experience, the visceral experience which it represents. You talked about even in reading it, that was redescription, because what it did was it gave intonation and moments of overlay over that work of art that you might not have had if you read it to yourself. Redescription and reinterpretation, that's what.
But I don't see the connection. I mean, what he did actually helped me to appreciate the poem better or see it maybe slightly differently. Mm-hmm. But if you had just shown me, okay, this is what your brain is doing, that's the scan, and this area is lighting
but
up.
But that wouldn't
here,
be neuroscience. That would not be neuroscience if I just showed you pictures of a brain without telling you what it was doing.
Well, and explained to me what system is now engaged and, you know,
mm-hmm.
how
did anyone else find the description of learning something about the default mode network at all interesting and thinking about what's going to happen the
well,
next time you see a work of art?
Well, I found it interesting, but I didn't get anything more about my aesthetic experience from it. Okay,
did anyone get any more?
I mean, to sharpen it, I mean, the worry is that there's no question that the work of art is an object, and therefore the work of art triggers neurological responses. The question is it zeroing in a way that helps us understand art? That's our topic. This issue about agreements and disagreement and liking and not liking is important. It came up between you and Blake Gopnik, but I think it deserves more stating. I mentioned this remark of Wittgenstein's, that the question is not whether you like it, it's why do you like it? But of course, the one who's really relevant here is Kant, because Kant appreciated that it's the curious sort of logical feature of the domain of the aesthetic that we simultaneously, it's only a matter of feeling, it's only a matter of response, and yet we feel that the disagreements between us are substantial and that they cry out for more talk, for more explanation, for more justification, for more elaboration, and that's the mark of the aesthetic, I would say, not like, dislike, good, bad. It's that logical space of irresolvable difference where we nevertheless think that there's something at stake.
I would say that's part of the shape of aesthetics, but I would say, and certainly I would not claim mere liking. I think that means that it's completely, the field is indistinguishable. I don't think looking at an artwork or listening to a poem is like drinking a glass of wine. But I do think that there is a particular kind of liking that goes with aesthetic experience. And I'm interested in helping to understand what that particular kind of liking is. So we can debate all night as to whether or not that's what you're interested in about it. But that's what I'm interested in about it.
So it has occurred to me since the beginning of this that it, regardless of who you are physically, it is, if it's a debate, it's sort of from a very, very, very old human technology to a very young one that's just making kind of baby steps in the history of its growth. And so it made me wonder what was at stake on both sides. Like, Alva, do you want neuroscience, are you asking neuroscience to get sharper and sharper and more specific and be careful? Or are you asking it to stop? And in your on your correlation, are you satisfied yet with the types of experiment you can actually get good data from? What is your ideal dream experiment? What do you actually want to find out?
Well, I can be quite brief. I don't want neuroscience to stop at all, but I think that there's something akin to a real conceptual confusion here. art is not a phenomenon that we should try to explain. Art is itself a domain of investigation. It's a domain of research. And it's as complex and as multifarious as any other domain of research. And it has a real unity, but it's not the unity of something going on inside us.
I would say that every experiment teaches you about what's possible in the next one. And science is some 80% of the time doing it wrong, yeah. And then learning from having done it wrong and trying to do it right the next time. So from this experience, we decided, you know, maybe the way that we operationalize this in the 1-4 scale is not the best. It's an artifact of a particular kind of technology we have. We've changed that. We've looked at, as I said, doing work in museums. We've moved on from working on static visual objects to working with with poetry, which is a very, very new field of investigation in the neuroscience of aesthetics. So every step leads to a particular different step. And I don't know what my ideal experiment would be, because that's part of the fun of discovery. There will be a new door that's opened the next time around, and I will be happy to walk through it.
Hi, so I just want to say that among other things, like being an artist, I'm also a psychotherapist dealing with trauma, and neuroscience has been a great boon to my understanding, my explanation of a phenomena related to traumatic symptoms. I really am a very firm believer in the promise of neuroscience, although I also know that there are many cautions that need to be observed. My particular interest, and this is for you, Professor Starr, in your investigation of responses to art, and I'm afraid that my interest in responses to art goes beyond what everybody is calling as the aesthetic experience, because that seems to be, and perhaps it comes out of some philosophical background where aesthetic experience has been described, I think it has been, and then now it's neuroscience going to see if, you know, parts that see if it actually exists in the brain. I'm interested, and I think you sort of hinted it, that your findings hinted it, that there is an actual qualitative difference as manifested in the different places that light up in the brain between the experience of an object of art and other objects. And for me, that speaks to the whole notion of this universality of art and how art has always seemed to have existed from as far back as we can find, is like 45,000 year old beads and things like that, or shells that show that there's some interest in something that is aesthetic. And that, for me, what I would love to see neuroscience find is something that will shed light on, what I like to say, why is art, not as it was used in one of the presentations, but is there something about human nature that inherently requires art, and can your research ever suggest that?
So I would say that as we understand what, how art is engaged in neural processes, we can learn how art relates to other kinds of experience. And I think that we can, you know, there are different extremes of claims that you can make. So Randy Buckner at Harvard studies the default mode network. He makes the argument that it's the emergence of deep cortical folding that is maybe, you know, that's after macaques and humans being separated, and really in the period just that is leading up to the Homo sapiens and the discovery of fire. And that deep cortical folding enables the crosstalk that allows, for him, particularly mind wandering. And his argument, and I'm not sure that I would buy this, but I think it's interesting, his argument is that if art is a kind of gateway into this space of mind wandering in some ways, and art can do many other things, that art was produced in that space of mind wandering, that we were able to think in different ways, and we needed something to fill it. And what filled it were these kinds of new objects that enabled us to communicate with one another in ways that it never had before. And I think that's an appealing story.
I don't know if I'm going to give it 100% credence, but it's appealing.
Hi, this is a question for Gabrielle. Maybe about the sonnet and haiku study, and maybe you said that in the presentation and I missed it. It's a little bit more of a methodological question than some of these really high-level questions. But you had, I think, three dimensions that you had looked at: arousal, imageability, and vividness. And vividness seemed to be particularly important for both, although there was some distinction there. And I'm just wondering how you sort of operationally define, like, what do you think vividness is? Because I could see that referring to a number of things in the context of sonnets and haikus.
So in the instructions, I think essentially we say that you're going to have different kinds of we're not saying it's all visual, but vividity is how clearly you can see or hear or smell or taste or touch or manipulate what it is that you are engaging. The operationalization of valence, because one of the things that we were interested in was saying, if you see something vividly when you're reading, maybe what you're seeing is something you don't like. And so that was one reason that valence became a question. Is this something that is, there is one that haiku that people tended not to enjoy about a young girl drunkenly in the bushes vomiting. And the more vividly people saw that, the less they liked it. We wanted to be able to increase the amount of the variance in people's responses by asking that question. And the group that we're working in with at Michigan State is another set of questions that they've been using about the intensity of feeling as well as positive and negative responses that are pretty interesting.
I was wondering, because we've talked about genre, if advertising is considered a form of art, and how you would apply neuroscience to that, because if advertising is in front of you with the intention for you to purchase something, can we learn about the brain and how, if there's aesthetic rules to how to advertise to drive people to the store to go spend some money? So taking it kind of outside of the neuroscience to action.
Yeah. I mean, there are people who do decision making in neuroscience and thinking about how decision making can lead to, value can lead, have a decision output, right? Perceived value or received value. But again, this is the piece by Bill Seeley on this is really interesting because he starts off with an actual Brillo box, which is, as we know, created by an artist who went into advertising to pay the bills, and then the Brillo box that is the, you know, the contemporary artwork, right? That is, and how those two are different, and what about the responses to those could be captured by neuroscience? And I think that's probably the best piece that I've seen on it.
What's the name?
It's Bill Seeley. It's in the it's a collection by Nadal Huston, H-U-S-T-O-N, that came out from Oxford this year.
I think it's important to try to differentiate art from advertising. And I would propose that, exactly as you said, advertising has a clear objective, a clear aim. So there's a sort of a standard by which you can measure whether it's successful. I don't think that is ever the case with art. However, it's important to realize that these things mutually influence each other. And also things can play double duty. Things can both be art and non-art at the same time. So in real life, it becomes very complex to differentiate the ways in which art loops down and shapes advertising, which actually affects art, which affects the advertising, which affects art. In general, that you have that structure with life and art.
Sure. This is about a comparison drawn within Professor Noe's argument originally, with regard to a comparison between aesthetic experience and basically like eating a meal. It occurred to me that a lot of those parallels could also be drawn to research within neuroscience. I was thinking specifically of episodic memory and how you'll be hard-pressed to find first-order commonalities between episodic memory, how an episodic memory would be shaped by all kinds of factors above the neurological level, who you're with, you know, your emotional state at the time, whatnot, and also about how...
You mean the content of the memory?
Well, the content, like, in terms of emotion or just, you know, just semantic stuff, but it occurred to me that you can draw parallels between aesthetic experiences and that with episodic memory. So from that, I reasoned that accepting that type of argument could actually impose constraints on how you would interpret neuroscientific findings in other domains of research. So I was wondering about that argument, whether if these things count against a field of inquiry, you know, effectively, you know, being a valid target of neuroscience, that if that would constrain the way we interpret findings elsewhere.
Certainly that would be true if the comparison between my analysis of the aesthetic experience case and this episodic memory is right. I have no belief that it is, but if you were right, you could try to extend it. But the basic point I was trying to make is that there is a unity to aesthetic experience. It's the unity of an activity or a project rather than the unity of a sensation or a single response. And it's one whose unity is sort of a concern with its own status, and it's questioning itself.
My question, I'm a young art historian, and I have interests in neuroscience, having worked at, in neuroscience labs before. And I was just wondering to what extent you do collaborate as a neuroscientist with an expert in the visual arts, i.e. an art historian. We've seen very productive work come out of labs that put together art historians with conservators, physicists, chemists to do these interesting technical studies. But to what extent do you collaborate with art historians and bridge that gap?
So I love the fact that I just got this taken for a neuroscientist. I'm an English professor who collaborates with a philosopher and a neuroscientist and another English professor and a psychologist. And David Friedberg was supposed to be on this project, but he's gone AWOL. And a historian of science and sociologist of science. So we have a pretty interesting cross-section of people who are trying to think about these perspectives from different ways, because none of us have all of the expertise that would be able to answer these questions. And that's actually one of the things that I think is really useful about the neuroscience of aesthetics, because it gives you opportunities for collaboration. And when we have these arguments in the lab, sometimes I expect the knife to come out at the very next minute, but so far, there have been no knives.
Yeah. So I'm having a little trouble keeping in focus what's at issue between the two of you. I can see you want to disagree, but what exactly do you disagree about? So rather than inviting you just to restate your positions, I'm going to make a point rather abstractly and then try and illustrate it with some of the materials from the discussion. So here's two ways you might disagree. The first way is this, that Alva thinks that to understand art as art involves deploying understanding with respect to a category so general that it won't show up at all from the neuroscientific point of view. That's the kind of line he's pressing when he talks about art as a project of inquiry. Nothing will unify a project of inquiry at the neuro level. That's one way you might disagree. Another way you might disagree is this, that you both accept that the relevant category to understand art as art is at a level of generality that will show up at the neuroscientific perspective, but that the neuroscientific perspective on that category won't be illuminating of art as art. And when Gabby was debating with Anya about the default mode network and things, the debate seemed to be more of that quality. So Anya was really saying, look, it's a phenomenon here that may have a neuroscientific correlate, but learning about the neuroscience doesn't tell me about what I want to know about it. So the question simply is, which, if either, of those two debates do you take yourselves to be having?
Both. But not only that, there's other things at stake as well. And most importantly, I think that, well, there's at least those two at stake. Why not?
Because he said it's too general to show up as the first case. And the second case was that it would show up, but it'd be uninteresting.
No, there's all sorts. I believe that everything we do has correlates in the brain. There's, I think Zeki is right about that. There's no activity, there's no conversation, there's no nothing that doesn't have correlates. The question is whether those correlates are explanatory in any sense at all. So for or you might even think they're explanatory in some sense, but that they're not causally interesting. So for example, there are some people who believe, I'm not saying that I believe this, but there are some people who believe that there are cognitive differences between men and women. If there are cognitive differences between men and women, then I would expect it to be the case that there are neurological differences. But are the cognitive differences explained by those neurological differences? Or are those neurological differences explained by the cultural factors that produce the difference? So there may be all sorts of things going on in the brain that we can pick out from the standpoint of art. But fundamentally, my concern is that we're looking for art in the wrong place. We're, the aesthetic experiences are works of art are not objects. They're things we do with objects in this. It's a little bit like philosophy. Could there be a neuroscience of philosophy? I suppose you would think that there could be.
I'm not sure anyone would care to explore.
But so the claim is, I do not wish to deny. I do not wish to deny that there are neural processes, neural structures that subserve all the faculties that get exercised in the experience of art. The question is, as Anya was suggesting, do we learn anything about those faculties or what interests us?
It doesn't follow from that concession that the phenomenon that has unity at the level of human experience also has unity at the neuroscientific level. And I heard your whole analogy with the dinner and art as a project is really trying to argue that there won't be any unity at the neuroscientific level, even though there will, of course, be correlates for every aspect.
It depends upon what you mean by unity, right? I mean, yes, I don't think there is any unity, but I think what allows us to say that is something like, it does no explanatory work.
But it could also do no explanatory work, even if there is unity, right? That was the second line I was pressing. So you might think that if all known network, there's a neurophysiological phenomenon that maps onto a first...
There's a neurophysiological phenomenon that maps onto an experiential level phenomenon, but think that neuroscientific understanding of that phenomenon does not tell you what you want to know about the experiential level phenomenon. And that I took was the second line. So when Wittgenstein says, if there couldn't be a science of aesthetics because you'd have to be able to see that its claims were true, he's really pressing that kind of thought, I think, that what he wants is an understanding of our engagement with art that is transparent to the engager. And the neuroscientific understanding couldn't give us that. So whatever it's giving us, it's not giving us what we were looking for when we tried to understand art. And I'm not endorsing that view. I'm asking whether you do.
I do endorse that. But moreover, I want to just come... I think maybe the third thing that I think is the mark of disagreement, I want to come back to this. And it will sound aggressive and unfriendly after so much productive exchange. I still don't really see any neuroscience even really bringing art into the discussion, because to treat an art object as a stimulus for a neurological investigation is not for me to investigate the experience of art, because the experience of art isn't attached to the object. It has to do with the character of what we do with it. So I'm really not seeing, I'm just not seeing that there is anything that deserves to be called a neuroscience of art. We can argue with them about that. We can look at it, and the fact that they think it doesn't make it so. The fact that you think it doesn't make it so. Let's look at them. Let's look at what they're doing. Let's look at what they're doing. How many people pay $15 a head to go to MoMA every day? Are they getting aesthetic experience for the price of it? They're putting themselves in the proximity of art. Are they therefore having an aesthetic experience? Just merely looking at it and saying, I like it, count as having an aesthetic experience? I think that when I spent 2 hours looking at those Andy Warhol pictures, I was amazed that, and this will sound like a kind of a cocky thing to say, but I was amazed that I didn't see anybody else looking at those paintings. They thought they knew them. They didn't need to look at them because they thought they knew what was there. They'd seen the poster. They'd seen the lithographs. Or the silk screens, rather. So they just kept on going, and they took a lot of selfies in front of it. Were those aesthetic experiences? I'm not being facetious. I think of art as important, and I don't think you get it just by looking. Yeah, and I think, and this relates to the expertise issue.
Can you get it just by reading?
No, that's why I said about.
Well,
the thing is, you can get it, but this is what I was just about to say. This goes to the expertise question. And I don't think that you need to appeal to the contrast between elites and the masses to make this point. Anybody, whether it's pop music or any hip hop, when people argue about music, and they do, kids, teenagers, my children argue about music, and they're appealing to modes of expertise that are based on what they know, and they're hearing relationships between one song and another song, and they're aware that this person isn't clued in. This person doesn't get the joke because they don't know. Even at the level of, oh my God, you've never heard X? How could you possibly think you're getting this if you don't realize that it's playing off of that? And that's not sort of a secondary phenomenon. That's what art is about.
I will counter merely by reading to you all a poem that I could read to you here. I could read it to you in a car. I could read this poem to you in a car. I could read it to you. We'll go Dr. Seuss. I could read it to you in a magnet. I could read it to you in a meeting. And I think that you can have an aesthetic experience by hearing, just by hearing it. When the cry within says, go on, then I go on, till the longing is less and the good gone. But down drop if it says stop to the olive leaf of the treetop, and after that off the bough. The blue wheat acres underneath, and the braided ear breaks out of the sheath. The ear and milk lush the sash, and crush silk poppies a flash. The blood gush, blade gash, flame rash, rud red, bud shelling or broad shed. Tatter a tangle and dingle a dangle a dandy hung dainty head. And down the furrow dry, sun spurge and ox eye and lace leaved lovely foam tuft fumatory. Through the velvety wind, V wing to the nest nook, I balance and boy with a sweet joy of a sweet joy, sweet of a sweet of a sweet joy of a sweet, sweet joy. And if you can hear that in here, you can hear it in MRI.
Oh, that may be true, but sure.
Experience it as pleasurable.
But isn't it obvious how much cultural social stage setting has to be in place for us to hear that as aesthetic?
Yeah.
And it's our shared appreciation of a place that it occupies in a culture of which we're a part. A child or a younger person might not be able to get it, might not hear anything in it, might not be engaged with it. Sorry?
We're gonna have one last question.
What's the poem? Hopkins is the Woodlark.
So this may come back to the question of expertise, but I personally spent a lot of my primary education in Asia, and when I was in a freshman kind of just general culture class, I found that when we were looking at translated texts from China and Japan, my classmates had a lot less appreciation of those translations. And so with your experiment about when you looked at haikus versus sonnets, to me, it's not surprising that people would find the same types of sonnets appealing, because in a Western education, we spend a lot of time learning how to look at sonnets versus when we look at haikus. At least in my primary education in America, I spent very little time learning how to look at a haiku and learning what's interesting about a haiku. So I guess I kind of wonder, how do you compensate for the fact that your data is contingent upon the characteristics of an audience?
So you can do that in several ways. The way we did it with the haiku is that we classified the objects as the set of poems that we had. One were all translations by Robert Haas that were, so we had a single poet translator. The others were, the other set were haiku written in English by Richard Wright. So we were able to show that these characteristics of response were indistinguishable for both of those cases, so that there's as much disagreement about Richard Wright as there is about the translations. So you can use that as a regressor to figure it out. You also can use as a regressor experience. And when we do, one of the things that we do is we do an aesthetic experience questionnaire in each of the different modalities in which we work, so that we know how many courses people took, how much they care about poetry when they come in, and you can also use that as a regressor to figure out what characteristics of your audience might be shaping what you're seeing.
Okay, let's thank our debaters.